As the cliche goes, April showers bring May flowers. But usually, what comes after is the heat and dryness of summer. Hello again, SA here. And before the hot weather of the holiday shows up, you should indulge in my new short story, The White Cat, a free exclusive on Substack. The links are down below in description. Join Margot Thompson, a beautiful stage actress and recent widow who finds salvation in the form of a white cat during a night of terror. While checking out my oddball thriller, remember that my Glitch series is still available at Amazon and Barnes and Noble. The links are down below in the description. While you'll find my peculiar story about a white pussy entertaining, that doesn't mean I'm out of ideas. I still have more stories coming down the pike, so as long as I don't run into any different mishaps. You'll see those stories as well. Now let's get back to the video.
What we won when all of our people united just must not now be lost in suspicion and distrust and selfishness and politics among any of our people. And believing this, as I do, I have concluded that I should not permit the presidency to become involved in the partisan divisions that are developing in this political year. With American sons in the field far away, with America's future under challenge right here at home, with our hopes and the world's hopes for peace and the balance every day, I do not believe that I should devote an hour or a day of my time to any personal partisan causes or to any duties other than the awesome duties of this office, the presidency of your country. Accordingly, I shall not seek, and I will not accept, the nomination of my party for another term as your president.
Hello again, SA here. Long ago, I believe it was Mark Twain who said, history doesn't repeat itself, but it does rhyme. Well, as someone else once said, may you live in interesting times. And boy, right now, in 2024, we certainly are. Because the word just came down the wire, or I should say Twitter, or X, that Joe Biden, the 46th president of the United States, has called it quits. And no, he didn't resign the presidency. He basically quit running for president for a second term. Now, of course, some of you say, oh, happy day. then you better hold on that. But for others, this is not the first time this has happened. Indeed, more than a handful of people who sat in the White House, you only sat there for one term. And no, I'm not talking about people like JFK who, let's just say this, they left the White House feet first, if you know what I mean. No, there was a handful of people who became president, but then made a conscious decision not to run for a second term. For example, there was Polk and Buchanan, Hayes, Coolidge, and Truman. Yeah, that's a good example. And in fact, I remember Teddy Roosevelt. You know, he initially, you know, became president accidentally, and then he ran in 1904, but then he left in 1908, even though technically he could have served another term, but he chose not to. But then he tried to come back in 1912 as part of the Bull Moose Party, but didn't succeed. And then, of course, there's the big one, you know, LBJ. And in fact, I was a wee little kid when that happened. But yeah, that was a big one because no one saw it coming. Because those other people I just mentioned, according to the history books, all of them, except for Truman, no voice publicly that if they became president, they would only serve one term, and they stuck to their word. But in the case of Calvin Coolidge, if I remember correctly, he made a public announcement in 1928 that he just wasn't going to run because he just didn't have it in him. Apparently, the guy didn't like Washington, D.C., and he felt that, I think he was vice president, I think, for like 2 or 3 years, and then president for like 6 years. Yeah, I think he had enough. And therefore, he, exit stage left. And in the case of Truman, I think he initially wanted to run for another term, but the party leadership basically talked him out of it. So he didn't run in 1952. But in the case of Johnson, he had a lot of problems. Indeed, Vietnam was not going well. And this young kid, Robert Kennedy, he beat him in the New Hampshire primary. And I guess LBJ decided right then and there, well, being president apparently isn't my cup of tea anymore. And he made that public announcement right after that he wasn't going to run for another term. But what's going on right now? It's very odd. Because at least LBJ went on TV and announced he wasn't going to run. The fact that Biden used Twitter or X, that was very strange. Very strange. Now, I'm going to show you a snippet of a video from those two Greek brothers at Duran.com, and they get into real nuts and bolts about what may be going on behind Biden bowing out. Okay, are you ready? Here we go.
Breaking news, historic news. Alexander, as I do a quick check to make sure we are live on all of the platforms, welcome to everybody that is joining us. What is going on in the world today?
Well, Zelensky's curse has now bagged its biggest victim. Joe Biden has announced that he is not going to run for the presidency of the United States in November. I'm sure this has come as a shock to everybody. After all, we all knew what a dynamic, energetic, incisive, brilliant man he was, fully in command of his brief. But events proved otherwise. He went down to a disastrous debate with Donald Trump. the party, the Democratic Party, en masse turned against him. It's very interesting now that we see that Barack Obama orchestrated it, and that tells us who is really running the Democratic Party now. That's an important fact in itself. Something I have not understood at all is the role of the donors, but apparently they played a decisive role. It seems that they were able to withhold money that they had assigned or donated or allocated to the campaign, and that basically left Joe without money. And the result is that he's now had to accept very grudgingly, very angrily, he doesn't want to go, that he has to go. And he made an astonishing statement. I don't think people understand how bizarre it actually was, because he announces that he's achieved all these great things. He's led the United States through crisis. He's made it stronger than ever. He's got the best economy in the world. He's overcome a crisis in the economy as great as that of the Great Depression, which to anybody who is at all familiar with the history of the Great Depression would know how bizarre that is. But then without any explanation at all, he suddenly announces over the course of this statement that he's not going to seek re-election. He says he's going to do that for the good of the country, but he doesn't give a reason why he is standing down. He then makes it absolutely clear that he intends to remain president until January, until, in other words, the new president, the president who's elected in November, is going to be inaugurated. So even though he's not standing as a candidate for the presidency, he's going to remain president until January. And then in his actual statement, he doesn't endorse anybody. He doesn't say that he backs Kamala Harris. It is takes a couple of a short period of time for a completely separate statement to suddenly appear on social media saying that he's actually going to back Kamala Harris. And again, I'm not going to say that I know for a fact that this is so, but I suspect that the old man was told, you've got to back Kamala Harris. He didn't want to do it. He didn't want to step down as a candidate. He didn't want to do any of the things that he's doing now. And he's going to provide the American people and the world with an explanation sometime this week. He isn't giving us an explanation now. And it's not difficult to work out why there is this delay, because the wordsmiths, the people who are going to have to explain for the president in the statement he's going to read out, are going to have their work cut out explaining the contradiction. The contradiction between the president announcing that he is not going to run for the presidency, obviously because his health and his physical condition is not strong enough to do it, and the fact that nonetheless he considers that he's still fit and capable enough to be president of the United States. Now, on the Duran, we were pointing out several days ago, when all the rumors that he would have to stand down were circulating, that this is an unsustainable position, that he can't at one and the same time say that he's not fit enough to run for the presidency and at the same time continue to be president. But as of now, he has made no attempt to explain that contradiction. And he continues to insist that he wants to remain president. And of course, the Republicans are homing in. Marco Rubio started it earlier today. Then J.D. Vance did. Now Josh Hawley has done. Others who are not Republicans, like Jonathan Turley, the legal professor, he's pointing out that this makes absolutely no sense at all. But there it is. He didn't want to go. He is furious with all of the people who pushed him out. He's very, very angry with Obama. This is what the New York Times is telling us, because he feels that Obama has undermined him. And he's absolutely right about that, by the way. He's furious with the entire Democratic Party. I know that he wanted to endorse Kamala Harris, which is why he didn't endorse her in this statement. But he wants, nonetheless, in spite of everything, to remain president. Now, this could be the death rattle of the Democratic Party. I mean, to try to explain to the American people all of these contradictions, the contradictions of why they backed Joe Biden for so long, pretending that he was, as I said, this great incisive leader and manager that they were saying he was, when he obviously wasn't, why they suddenly turned on him, why they did so purely when it looked like he was about to lose the election, and how they're going to explain that they now support Kamala Harris, but Biden is still president. I really don't know how they explain all of these things, how they square the circle, but American politics is nothing if not unusual and unpredictable, and we'll just have to see what happens. Anyway, those are my initial thoughts.
They all hate each other, don't they? Obama's, Clinton, Biden's. Because earlier in the day, NBC News was reporting that Clinton was behind Biden. She wanted Biden to stay, the Clinton family. So, I mean, I guess you could see the power struggles that were going on over the past couple of weeks between all the families, the clans.
Well, you're absolutely right. The Democratic Party, the party of Franklin Roosevelt and John F. Kennedy and Robert Kennedy Sr. and all of these, it doesn't exist anymore. What we have is a collection of factions and clans who fight each other constantly as they struggle relentlessly for patronage and control of the party and of its political machinery. It has some kind of neoliberal ideology, which it promotes across the country. It has a certain ideology of identity politics, but it is no longer what it used to be, the party of the working class of the United States. It abandoned the working class years ago. The working class are now shifting to supporting the Republican Party. One of the most important events, underreported in my opinion, one of the most important events of this extraordinary week that has just passed was the fact that the Teamsters leader, the leader of the most powerful union in America, went to the Republican convention and addressed the Republican convention. So the American working class, the blue collar workers, are now supporting the Republicans. They have parted company with the Democrats, and what is left of the old Democratic Party is a husk consisting of various factions, all of whom, exactly as you've just said, hate each other, struggle for power, constantly fighting for power, for control of the levers of power, and for the patronage and the clientage, and to put it mildly, to say it simply, the money that comes with it.
Right. Okay, so let me ask you one more question, and then we'll get to some of the questions from everybody, and we'll wrap up this update, this breaking news. The geopolitics of this, what do you think the world is saying as this goes down? Russia, China, the European Union, what do you think is going on? India, what are they saying?
They are asking the same question that people in the United States today should be asking. Who is running the United States? It can't be Joe Biden. If he's not fit to be candidate for the presidency, and he clearly isn't, by the way, we've all seen the kind of person that he has become. If he is not able to run the United States at this time, who is? Who do they call if there is a crisis? Do they speak to Obama? Because Obama apparently can make or break presidents. He made Joe Biden, and now he's broken him. Do they call Obama? Do they call, God help us, Tony Blinken or Jake Sullivan? Whom do they call? So that is the question that all the major governments of the world are asking at this precise moment. Now, every other government, of course, has its issues with the United States, be they friends or enemies. And they will all be trying to work out now what is going to happen over the next 10 months until January. And they will be very concerned. They will be very worried because they sense a vacuum of power at the center in Washington. Nobody, as I said, clearly in control. They will be very worried that the president, the current president, the incumbent president, assuming he stays, is going to try to do something dramatic and dangerous in order to secure his legacy. They will be worried too about some of the people around him, and most of the world has seen them and measured them and come to the view that Jake Sullivan and Tony Blinken and all of the others are no more fit to do the job than the president himself is. So they will be worried about that. They will be calculating that this is a very, very dangerous time indeed. And they will all be asking what the next president, the next true president of the United States, the one who's going to be elected in November, is going to do. And they will now be hoping, because most of the world wants certainty, they will be hoping that it is Donald Trump, with the exception of Europe. We'll come to Europe in a moment. But most of the world now wants Donald Trump to win, because they want somebody in Washington who is back in control. And they will be beating their, you know, they will be going to Donald Trump's door, trying to work out what his policies are going to be, what he's intending to do when he is president. They'll be crossing their fingers, hoping that he is going to become president. They'll be wanting to know what he's going to do about Ukraine, the Middle East, East Asia, Taiwan, the global economy, all of these things, all of which they're now worried about. The only part of the world that is going to be in crisis, in absolute meltdown at this moment, is Europe. All of the European states have tied themselves to the sinking ship that is the Biden administration. And incredible thing to do. We discussed this in program after program on the Duran. What an idiotic thing that was that they did. Now that ship is visibly sinking. In fact, it's sunk. And they are going to be absolutely terrified. They're going to be absolutely spooked up and wondering, what is this Trump administration, which is coming, going to do? They'll be worried that the Trump administration is going to cut them off. It's going to leave them hanging out to dry over Ukraine. It's going to do all sorts of things that they don't want. And they brought it about because they've refused to talk to Trump. They've acted as if Trump really is the person that Joe Biden and all the people around him say he is. And now they are in very, very serious trouble. But we mustn't focus too much on Europe. The Europeans have their own set of problems brought about by their incompetent and mismanaged politics. Most of the rest of the world, Russia, China, India, all of the African states, all of the East Asian states, all of the Latin American states, they want Trump to win. Even the Chinese, who have had a difficult relationship with Trump, though not as difficult as some people say, they want Trump to win because they want somebody in Washington that they can telephone and speak to and deal with, in the belief that he can actually run the government of the United States and provide a coherent way forward for the United States.
Man, the Europeans, they followed Biden straight into a war with Russia. What a mess up. Wow.
Absolutely. Well, you know, do you remember? I'm sure you do remember. I've seen him cite some other people now cited that, you know, we spoke about that Charlton. We went in back in 2020 when they nominated him as a candidate. We spoke about that Charlton Heston film, in which Charlton Heston plays the Spanish knight El Cid, who's tied to the horse and sent into battle, even though he's actually dead. Well, that is exactly what they did. They let themselves be followed by a man who, politically speaking, was essentially a corpse. And of course, instead of leading them into battle, he's led them off the cliff. And that's what they've done to themselves. It was astonishing. It was absolutely bizarre. But that's what they did. That's what Ursula von der Leyen, Olaf Scholz, Emmanuel Macron, the endless election of British Prime Ministers, Johnson, Truss, Sunak, even Starmer, the last person
last week
tells us last week tells us, you know, what a brilliant and incisive and, oh, you know, on top of the world and it's master of detail Biden is. They have brought all this upon themselves and upon Europe as well.
All right. Do you have anything else to add, or should we get to questions, Alexander?
Well, let's go. Just...
All right. You saw that. Now, of course, it's quite likely, we have no proof, that there was some little fancy dance going on in the background that most people couldn't see. Now, did Barack Hussein Obama bring out the big hook, like something out of the old Gong Show, and just grab Biden and said, okay, you're done, and just pulled him off the stage? Well, if he did, we'll never know. And as for Cackling Harris, oh boy. Yeah. Out of the frying pan into the soup. Now, of course, Biden hasn't resigned from the presidency. But considering everything that we've been seeing for like the last three, almost 4 years now, it makes you wonder if that's going to be the other shoe that drops. Yep. Now, of course, back in 68, LBJ actually stuck around until the inauguration of Richard Milhouse. Now, will Biden do the same thing? I don't know. But as Mark Twain said, there's so much about what's going on now reminds me too much of 68. Because, like I said, we got a overseas war that's turned to a total shit show. We have a president who is extremely unpopular. Yeah, because nobody liked LBJ back in 68 either. And, of course, we have a Robert Kennedy Jr. who's running for president. Actually, against Biden and Trump. And then we recently had an assassination attempt. Of course, it wasn't against Kennedy, it was against Trump. And I guess the angels were smiling on Trump because the damn shooter missed. And then, of course, we have this convention coming up in a little more than a month's time in Chicago for the Democrats. And of course, anyone who read a history book knows what happened back in 68, the last time Democrats showed up in the Windy City for a Democratic convention. It turned into a total Donnybrook. I mean, you didn't have to watch an old dog-eared copy of Medium Cool to know how bad it got in Chicago in 68. I mean, it was bonkers. Total bonkers. Now, will it happen again? Don't know. Honestly, don't know. But the way the trajectory is looking, we might have a replay of the 68 election where the vice president, a Democrat, runs for president against a Republican who, remember, Nixon was never president before 68. He was the vice president under Eisenhower. So technically he wasn't quite an incumbent, but close enough. And of course, we know Nixon won. And of course, right now, all we need is a bunch of long-haired hippies hanging out on the street corner in their Birkenstocks and tie-dye shirts and smoking weed. Oh, that's right. In California, you have that going on right now. It's that we don't call them hippies, we call them homeless. Yeah. No joke. In fact, the only thing that's different between now and 68 is the music. I mean, the music nowadays is just garbage. And I know some of you Swiftie fans out there probably saying, oh no, Taylor Swift's great. Yeah, if you want to hear about some woman complaining about all her old boyfriends with a soundtrack in the background. I mean, at least back in 68, had a lot of good music to listen to. I mean, you had the Stones, you had the damn Beatles. And in fact, now I think about it, the Stones are still around. But for how long Mick and Keith gonna be around is anyone's guess. Since Charlie Watts kicked the bucket, but yeah. And of course, Sir Paul and Ringo, they're technically still around, but I don't think they haven't put out any music out in a while. And then of course you had The Who, and you had Eric Clapton. And Eric Clapton, he's still around. But he hasn't put anything out in years either. And Stevie Wonder, he was around back then too. And my gosh, old Stevie, I don't think he hasn't put out any music out since the 20th century. Yeah, I guess he figured after putting out a whole bunch of albums back in the 1960s during his heyday, he figured he can sit back and relax now. And of course, in the case of The Who, yeah, Roger Daltrey and Pete Townshend, they're still around. But yeah, they haven't put out any music out in a while either. Yep, I think that's the only real difference between now and 68. The music here and now is garbage. The music back in the 60s, pretty good. Yeah, I got a whole bunch of old 8-tracks sitting over there in the corner from the 60s. And the 70s too, which I'm not going to get into. So what happens next? Well, as long as no one takes any more pock shots at either Trump or Robert Kennedy Jr. or Cackling Harris, I guess the election will likely go the same way it did in 68. Let's not even pretend. The Democrats, they basically shot their wad. I mean, for over a whole year, they've been doing everything to kneecap Trump. I mean, first they tried to kick him off the ballots in various states. That didn't work. They tried to put him in jail over bullshit criminal charges. And most of those criminal charges were either set aside, like the one in New York, or the charges were dropped completely, like in Florida. Remember that documents case? Yeah. And then, of course, finally, well, they tried to kill him. Yep. But unlike with Robert Kennedy back in 68, the shooter missed. So I guess in that aspect, the history isn't going according to plan. So what happens next? Well, I guess after the convention, I guess we'll see who the nominee actually will be. Now, it could be Cackling Harris, or it might turn into a real Donnybrook and he might get Big Mike. Or worse, Oprah Winfrey. And you say, what? Yeah. I mean, let's not pretend. You don't think that in her subconscious mind, Oprah Winfrey never considered the idea, the possibility that she could be president of the United States? Of course she has. I mean, as Springsteen once said in one of his better songs, a poor man wants to be rich, and a rich man wants to be king. Well, Oprah, she started out poor, and now she's rich, and now what's left but to be king? I mean, you can say the same thing about Trump. Yeah, you probably can. this thing with Biden? Yeah. I guess we probably knew it was going to happen. Either he was going to, you know, drop out of the race, or worse, he would actually make it to the election and, my God, win, and then bow out, and then Kathleen Harris would then have the presidency all to herself for the next 4 years. I mean, I think that was the game plan. But apparently too many people in the DNC decided Biden was so rickety, like a $2 suitcase left in the rain, that they guess they didn't think he was going to make it to the convention, let alone the actual election in November. So there you go. And of course, those two brothers at Duran.com, who you saw their video, they're practically laughing out loud, because as far as people outside the United States are concerned, as you saw in their video, the damn people in the EU and NATO are having a total freak out, because they basically hitched their wagon to basically a lame horse. And they probably knew it, but I guess they probably were, what's the old cliche, whistling through the graveyard, hoping that nobody else would notice. Boy, everybody else did notice, and now they're stuck in more ways you can imagine, which I'm not going to really get into. So yeah, seems like we are repeating history, or imitating a period in the past in history. I mean, did anyone have this on their scorecard a year ago? Probably not. I mean, me personally, I wasn't making any predictions. I mean, personally, I thought that the Democrats were going to pull some kind of shenanigans to keep Trump from running, or at least, you know, treat an election like what happened in 2020. Nope. I didn't expect this to happen. So I guess we just have to keep our eyes and our ears open, because it ain't over yet. Nope. We still have about, I think, 3 or 4 months until the election. And the way things are going now, I mean, you better have your seatbelt on and hang on to your hats, because we don't know what's going to happen next. Nope, we don't. We can only hope that someone doesn't do anything stupid or crazy. Well, that's all I got to say about old Scranton Joe bowing out, or someone making him bow out. And that's my opinion.